What's up, guys? Welcome to the Chess Giant. This is Solomon Riddell, and in today's video, we cover the Smith-Morra Gambit, one of the most seasoned gambits for the E4 player against the Sicilian Defense. And this is really for you aggressive and attacking players who are willing to give up a pawn and in return gain rapid development and great attacking chances, putting a ton of pressure against the black camp with a ton of chess opening tricks and traps, and really giving the Sicilian Defense player a tough game to navigate. Now here we're not going to play the main line of knight f3 looking to support this move d4, but instead we're just going to play the move d4 right away, and once black captures the pawn, we're not worried about evening out the material. In fact, we're going to offer up another pawn with the move c3, and there's a couple of different ways that black is able to decline the Smith-Morra Gambit, one of them being the move d3. Another option is knight f6, and we're going to cover both of these at the end of this video, but let's cover the obvious question: why can't black just take on c3? This is what you're going to see most of the time, and against this, we're now simply going to capture back with the knight. And now the next move, let's say black plays something like knight c6, we're just going to continue with knight f3. And here for black, there's usually two moves that you will see, either d6 or e6. Let's first take a look at the move d6. Now, in either case, we're going to play this move bishop c4, activating our light squared minor piece, putting some pressure on the f7 pawn. Now, here against this move bishop c4, the most popular option for black at the master and grandmaster level is e6. And we're going to cover this, but let's first take a look at a move like knight f6. Well, this just shows just how dangerous the Smith-Morra Gambit can be. In fact, against this move, we now see the purpose, or one of the purposes, of playing bishop c4, as we can now play the move e5. Some of you are wondering, how on earth does bishop c4 have anything to do with playing this move e5? Well, notice that black cannot take with either the pawn or the knight on c6. If knight takes e5, we're simply going to capture that knight back. And notice here that we can remove the defender of that queen on d8 by playing bishop takes f7 with check, distracting the king. And the very next move, at move 10, we simply want a queen. So knight takes e5 doesn't work because we simply take off that minor piece, followed by bishop takes f7, winning that queen on d8. What about the move d takes e5? Now, this also isn't the best option for black. Notice, by the way, that bishop takes f7 no longer works because now the knight defends the queen on d8. But here we're actually able to just take the queen right off the board. Most players are not going to play king takes d8 because knight g5 does look very intimidating, putting pressure on that f7 pawn. Most of the time, you're probably going to see this move knight takes d8. By the way, in either case, white does have a much better game. In fact, against knight takes d8, we're not going to waste time by playing a move like castling kingside or even capturing the pawn on e5. Guys, with the Smith-Morra Gambit, we have to attack aggressively every single move, starting off with knight b5, threatening knight c7 with check, simply winning that rook on a8. And here, if a move like rook b8 from black saving the rook, okay, we can now play knight c7 with check, and then bring this knight back. Some of you are wondering, why on earth are we going in a circle with our knight? Well, notice now that this king has moved. It can no longer castle. We're now threatening knight takes e5 with check, and now black can't play easy moves like e6, bishop b4 check, and castling kingside. This king is going to be a target for the rest of this game. And now against a move like knight c6, black trying to defend this pawn on e5, we actually now have a killer idea, and that is bishop f4. Putting a ton of pressure yet again on that centralized pawn. I mean, look, if black plays a move like e6, we just have knight takes e5 with check, and white is much, much better over a +2 advantage. But the big question, okay, why on earth did we just give up our bishop? I mean, if e takes f4, what does white have here? Well, we're now able to play rook d1 with check. And notice here, if black does not give up one of their minor pieces and instead plays the move king e8, we have knight c7 checkmate. We have ourselves a game over. So yeah, we just lost a piece, but we're getting one right back. And if you plug this into a computer program, it's going to tell you that knight d5 is the best option of the two, in which case we're going to play rook takes d5 with check. And here there's a few different options for white, but I think the best move is by far knight c7 with check, followed by knight e8. I mean, just throwing our knight into the back rank, attacking the opponent's king. And let's just be honest, guys. I mean, no Sicilian defense type player wants a position like this with active pieces all over the place and this king all the way out on f6. Notice here, if the move king e6 is played, we have knight g5 checkmate, game over. And if king g6 we're now able to play rook g5 with check. By the way, guys, I do recommend memorizing this line. I mean, this line of throwing our knight into e8 and chasing this king all the way out to g6, and the very next move, the square of h6, is very strong, but we do have to play this variation well. Following this move, king h6, one of the best options for white is g4, and really we're just trying to get this king at a mating net. Right now we're looking at rook h5 followed by knight h4 checkmate ideas. Notice how this knight on e8 takes away the square of f6. And here, if a move like g6 taking away rook h5 check, we can now play bishop takes f7, and all of a sudden black is going to have to play a move like rook g8 or bishop takes g4, just giving away material. Because if black plays a move like bishop d7, trying to somehow get a defensive presence in this game, we now have rook h5 with check, followed by g5, checkmate, game over. So all that to say, guys, I mean, black cannot take with either the knight or the pawn without getting into some serious trouble. If pawn takes, we're simply going to snatch off that queen on d8, and if king takes d8, play knight g5, and if knight takes d8, continue with knight b5. We're going to have a very active game ahead of us, and white is simply better. Now, what about a move here like knight g4? Black notices this and goes, look, I'm not trying to get into any of that mess. Well, now let's just take this pawn on d6, and one of the most interesting things I find about the Smith-Morra Gambit is that oftentimes we can trade queens and still have a very good attacking game. In fact, in this position, we could just continue by castling kingside. In most openings, if you give up a pawn, it is very good for the opponent if they can trade off. But even here, we do have a very good position as white. I mean, we're threatening knight b5 and knight c7 check ideas, and black is currently three moves away from getting that king castled. So knight b5 ideas are in the air. By the way, if a6, we still have knight d5 followed by knight c7. And here, if a move like bishop f5, which is the best option, prepared to play rook c8, defending that square, we can now just continue with a move like h3. We still have knight b5 ideas, even bishop f4 ideas, continuing to defend that square. And guys, white here has a +1 edge if black plays this game perfectly. I mean, I'm taking this as white every single time. So guys, I just wanted to show you that if you're playing the Smith-Morra Gambit, continuing with your natural chess of getting these knights out, playing this move bishop c4, and you see these moves d6 and knight f6 immediately, waste no time in playing that move e5. Now, what happens if black continues instead with a move like e6? Well, guys, the Smith-Morra Gambit is actually pretty easy to play with the white pieces, a very direct game plan in terms of development, and that is castling kingside followed by putting our queen on e2. Notice what we've done here. We have our knights on f3 and c3, a bishop on c4, which is still very active. We're tucking this queen away on e2, offering up this pawn on e4, some reinforcement, and the very next move, we're going to waste no time in playing rook d1, bringing this rook to the d-file, putting immediate pressure on the pawn on d6, and this is the type of position that you're going to see a ton if you do play the Smith-Morra. You're down a pawn, but you do have an edge in development. Obviously, here black has three minor pieces developed, and we do as well. The big difference is that we have a queen on e2, and this rook on d1, which is immediately putting pressure on d6, and by the way, black has not even castled. If black does castle here, we're able to continue with e5 expanding in the center. Notice how this pawn is pinned, so black cannot capture on e5 or even capture back with the knight, because we simply play knight takes e5 and we want a minor piece. So here black has to play a move like knight e8, and if they do this trying to hang on to d6, that's okay. I mean, let's just take that pawn off, continue here with a move like knight b5, and continue putting a ton of pressure on the black camp as quickly as we can. If black plays a move here like a6, going, look, what's the big deal? I mean, yeah, you're putting a lot of pressure on this bishop, but I do have two defenders. Okay, we can now continue with bishop g5. Again, guys, in the Smith-Morra Gambit, you have to continue putting the pressure on the black camp. And notice here, if a move like f6, it seems as if black has simply won a piece, right? I mean, they're attacking both the knight and the bishop, but notice now we're able to play the intermediate move of knight takes d6, and the very next turn, bishop f4. And now we see why we played bishop g5 and then bishop f4, so that this pawn can now be on f6, and now e5 is no longer available. Notice e5 cannot be played because it's currently pinned by the bishop on c4 to the king on g8. We're simply about to win this knight on d6, and if the knight plays a move like knight takes c4, okay, we simply win the queen. So let's say you continue with a move like bishop g5 and black notices your plan against f6 of taking on d6 and just dropping this bishop back to f4 and then continues with a move like queen d7. Well, now we're going to take on d6 and then play bishop f4. And again, guys, many of you are probably wondering, okay, why did we play bishop g5 and then bishop f4? Well, yet again, we would much rather have this queen on d7 because now against the move e5 with us taking back with the knight, we are now attacking the queen with tempo. And here, if a move like knight takes, we're simply going to take back with the bishop. And yet again, black has big, big problems to deal with here. So y'all, following this move of rook d1, if you see something like castling kingside e5 options, forcing this knight back, taking on d6, and just applying the pressure is going to give you a good middle game. Now, what happens if black gets the queen out of the way and plays a move like queen c7? Well, now we're going to play knight b5 followed by bishop f4. And guys, this is actually a good general strategy in the Smith-Morra. If you ever see these moves d6 and e6, develop your pieces like normal, but then put a ton of pressure on this pawn with moves like rook d1, bishop f4, and knight b5. And we're putting a ton of pressure on that pawn that really only has two defenders right now. And if black here plays a move like e5, we can now just play a move like bishop g5, threatening to take on f6. Notice how the pawn would have to take back, because if bishop takes, we simply win that pawn on d6. The queen on b8 is very awkward. Black is very underdeveloped. And on top of that, by playing this move e5, the light squares of d5 and f5 in this position are extremely weak. Another option instead of this move e5 is to play knight e5. But guys, here is white. We really do have two options. One of them is just dropping this bishop back to b3, continuing with rook c1, and playing normal Smith-Morra Gambit type chess. Another option, which the computer recommends, is this crazy line of knight takes d6 with check. This has been played at the master and grandmaster level. White is going to give up some material, but in return get an attacking edge. The whole idea here is that we are attacking this king, and the moment that this bishop captures back, we're going to take back with the rook, and the very next move, play knight takes e5. Now we're down the exchange, but we have a ton of play here. We have bishop b5 ideas in the air, checking the king. A move like rook d1 is also very easy, and even a move like knight g6, attacking this queen and attacking this rook on h8. And even against the move castling kingside, we're still able to play this move knight g6, right? I mean, the whole idea is that, look, if you want to take my knight, thank you for the queen. If you want to take my bishop, thank you for the queen. And here, if black just runs away with the queen somewhere like b6, we're able to capture that rook off the board. And guys, we're going to have the bishop pair and a very nice edge in development. I'm taking white there every time. So guys, in this position, we've covered moves like castling kingside, which runs into e5, and queen c7, which runs into knight b5 and bishop f4. What on earth should black do here? Well, the best move is surprisingly e5, and there's a very low chance that many of your opponents are going to find this move, because one of the biggest rules in Sicilian chess is to never play this move e5, because it really does weaken the light squares of d5 and b5, and it makes this pawn on t6 a big, big target. This is the best move for black, but here I still love white's game. In fact, we're able to play h3, preventing this bishop from ever even thinking about coming to g4. And here, if a move like castling kingside, just continue to develop. If a move like bishop e6, play rook ac1. Again, guys, putting these rooks on d1 and c1 is going to happen more oftentimes than not. And here, if a move like rook c8, okay, we'll take the bishop off the board. And now even continue with a move like b4. This is another key idea in the Smith-Morra. If your opponent is somehow able to navigate the entire opening without losing very quickly, here we're looking to play this move b5, kicking this knight around. Notice if knight takes b4, we simply take that pawn on e5, and this pawn cannot capture still because it's pinned by the rook on d1. Now, some may get very uncomfortable with this queen on d8. I mean, right now this rook is pouncing indirectly against that queen, right? I mean, every single move we have potential knight takes e5 ideas the second that this knight runs away. On top of that, if a move like queen c7, the queen is still under attack. If a move like queen b6, thank you for the queen. And if a move like queen a5, again, thank you for your queen. So what happens if black just starts to run away with a move like queen e8, getting this queen out of the line of fire? Well, we're now going to continue with b5, kicking this knight around. After a move like knight a5, continue with knight g5, attacking both the pawn on e6 and the pawn on a7. Black's position can fall apart very quickly, and white does have the edge. So y'all, in a position like this, after you play this very key idea of b4, whole idea being if knight takes b4, we simply take that pawn back on e5, and we have a nice fun game as white, and black plays a move here instead, like queen e8, getting this queen out of the line of fire. Okay, we can play b5, and after a move like knight a5, have bishop takes a7, and knight g5 ideas in the air. Now what happens here if black tries to prevent this move of b5 by playing the move a6? Now we can still play this move, but obviously this knight does not get kicked, as black can simply capture back. But now we take back with the queen, putting some pressure on b7. And here, if a move like queen d7, we continue with knight a4, continuing to activate our pieces, putting them in better positions. Right now, looking to play knight b6, attacking both the queen and that rook on c8. And if you like a position like this, where you're down a pawn, but you have two very active rooks, three active minor pieces, and an active queen with good attacking chances, the Smith-Morra Gambit might be for you. So y'all, we just covered the move d6, in which case we're going to waste no time in playing bishop c4, prepared to meet knight f6 with e5, and prepared to meet the move e6 with natural Smith-Morra chess. I mean, castling kingside, queen e2, throwing that rook to d1 as quickly as we can, putting pressure on that d6 pawn, getting our bishop on c1 and our rook on a1 both activated, and we're going to have ourselves a very active and fun game no matter what black plays. Now guys, what do I recommend that black play? Why doesn't white use this much at the elite grandmaster level? Well, if black plays this position perfectly, they are able to get a very slight edge, and that's by playing this move e6, prepared to meet bishop c4 with a6, preparing this move b5, which they're probably going to play the very next move, followed by bishop b7. But again, guys, we're just trying to play the Smith-Morra Gambit, and this is far from losing for white. We're playing queen e2 down a pawn, but we do have an edge in development, and it's still very hard for black to play. For example, if the move knight f6, we're now able to play e5, and all of a sudden, it's really black's best option is really to just go back home with the move knight g8, in which case we're able to play rook d1. Now, notice by playing the natural move knight f6, we were able to better our position by playing e5, forcing that knight right back to where it started, and then gaining yet another tempo with this move rook d1, eyeing that pawn on d7 with these squares of f6 and d6 being extremely weak. All that to say, guys, black really shouldn't play knight f6 in a position like this, but instead should continue with knight ge7, in which case we're now going to play bishop g5, trying to put as much pressure on the black camp as we possibly can. Here, if a move like h6, we're simply going to bring that bishop back to e3. Again, we're okay with playing bishop g5 and then getting kicked back, because we're actually okay with this pawn being on h6. It can eventually become a major target, especially if black tries to fianchetto this bishop. And there's a couple different moves here for black that are good. I mean, knight a5 is one of them, rook c8, but this is still hard for black to play. This is just not a natural position. This might be technically the best, and if black plays perfectly here, they're gonna have a solid game, but I wouldn't get too intimidated by the computer evaluation. In fact, right now, if black just plays a small little misstep with the move like knight g6, which looks very solid, all of a sudden we throw our knight into d5 in Smith-Morra Gambit type fashion. I mean, just throwing our knight in there, looking to play bishop b6, attacking this queen, and black has some big issues to resolve. If black takes the knight on d5, we're simply going to take back with e takes d5, and notice here that black cannot save the knight because we're going to play d6, attacking this minor piece yet again. And the moment this knight moves, we have bishop b6 with check, and we are about to win ourselves a queen because queen e7 runs into d takes. So y'all, knight e7 doesn't work because of d6, and this queen is eyeing the opponent's king. In the same way, after knight a5, we're able to play bishop b6 with check. Bishop c5 is also a decent option, but bishop b6 check is stronger. And following queen e7, we're able to play rook ae1. Now the best option here for black is to take this queen on e2, but some of you may be wondering, okay, why can't black just try to get something for this knight on a5, right? I mean, why not just take the bishop on b3 as an intermediate move? Well, now we're not going to take back this knight or even take the queen, but simply slide our queen back to a square like d1. All of a sudden, we're going to win ourselves a queen. So the Sicilian player has to be very careful here about moves like queen d1 or queen d3, and here should just take the queen right off the board. But against this, we're going to take back with check the very next move, capture that knight on a5, and here we as white have a solid playable position. So y'all, that is the meat and potatoes of the Smith-Morra Gambit. If black does take on c3, take back with the knight, continue to naturally develop your pieces, put a ton of pressure on the black camp, and you're going to have yourself a very fun game ahead of you. Now, what happens here if black doesn't want to accept that pawn on c3 and go into the very crazy accepted line? What if they're like, look, I don't want none of the smoke. I'm just going to play a move here like d3. This is probably the most popular move I see from black, trying to decline the gambit. But here we have a very simple and easy game. In fact, we can simply take back with the bishop. And now against knight c6, we could continue with a move like f4 and knight f3, or even just play knight f3 right away. And the very next move, I mean, let's say black plays something like d6, castle kingside, continue with queen e2, rook d1, e5 idea still in the air, and we simply have even material, and white has a very easy game. That's one way to play against this, by playing a move like f4 and then knight f3, or even knight f3 right away. Another option is to try to get a Meroxy bind type setup here with c4. Whole idea being that these pawns on c4 and e4 are really getting a grip on these light squares, and we're now going to continue with moves like knight c3, knight e2. If a move like knight f6, okay, we're just going to castle kingside, continue with h3 so that we can play bishop e3 without knight g4 ideas being available. And here, if a move like a6, play rook c1, and we're just playing chess. There is one more option here for black besides playing the move d3, which gives us a very simple and easy game, and that is this move knight f6. You may see this every once in a while. Again, I don't really think that white has much to worry about. In fact, we're just going to play this move e5, kicking this knight to d5, and now could even play this move knight f3. Notice, we don't need to be in a rush to take this pawn, because if d takes c3 is played, we simply win that knight. Now here, if black does play a move like e6, now the knight is defended, so we do have to take that pawn on d4. But now if a move like d6, we don't need to make this game easy for black by capturing and giving them easy development. Let's just continue here with a move like bishop c4, castling kingside, queen e2, and here if a move like castling kingside, play knight c3. If knight takes c3 is ever played, okay, we'll take back. And at any point, if black plays the move d takes e5, we simply take back with the d pawn. We have a space advantage. This pawn on e5 is controlling both d6 and f6, and this bishop on c8 is currently a pretty big issue for black. And we as white have the key idea of queen e4 and bishop d3, trying to put a ton of pressure on the king side of the board, trying to get this king in a mating net. We still have some very fun and decent attacking chess ahead of us. If you'd like to learn how to play the Danish Gambit, another fun option for white against the move e5, click the video to the left. If you'd like to see our top 10 chess openings for black against the move d4, click that video to the right. Leave a comment down below to let me know what other videos you'd like to see covered on this channel. And as always, I appreciate you guys. Thanks for watching. Peace.